Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome to the Chemed webinar on our inductor series. We are very pleased that you find the time to join our webinar. My name is Alexander Nebel. I am Field Application Engineer in the European Automotive and Global Account Team. So again, the topic today, we are now in the series for our inductors. On Monday, we had the first presentation of the basics of an inductor. If you missed that presentation, you can see the recording on our webpage. And today we will have part two, construction and characteristics of power inductors. So first, let me start to give you an overview of what I will present today. So I will start with the factors influencing the inductance. So how is the inductance calculated? Then I will go into the core material and permeability of the used material of the inductor. The third part is the wire structure. Then we will have a look in the mounting structure. And finally, I will show you the most interesting Chemed product types. So first I will start with the factors influencing the inductors. I'm quite sure everybody of you knows this formula you can see here at the top right. So this is how you calculate the inductance by using the permeability of the material. A is the cross section of the core, N is the number of turns, and effective length is L. So if you want to increase the inductance, you can either change the permeability or the size of the inductor. The most easiest way to change the inductance or the impedance is to change the permeability, because you don't want to have an increasing inductor by just having a high inductance value. On the other hand, to keep the component performance but having a higher permeability, you need also to have a lower cross section of the core, and also you want to have a less weight and a smaller case size. And you want to have less turns to use thinner wire to get the same RDC resistance. So this means it's always a trade-off, and the best solution is always to change something in the material. Now let's go into the number of turns. So number of turns, we can see this is the N. And if you want to increase the turns, it's not just increasing the inductance, but also you change the effective frequency range. So by increasing the number of turns, the resonant point changes to a lower band, which means you might have an situation but with your frequency range. And for sure, your impedance or your inductance will increase, but your resonance point will decrease. And this is very important. It's not so easy to make hundreds and thousands of turns on a coil, because here you can directly see that you also have an impact on your resonant point or on your frequency range. So it's not only what we see here on this formula is not only given to the inductance, also the frequency will change by changing the number of turns, or maybe also by changing the core material permeability. And now let's go deeper into the core material and the permeability. So again, what we see is that the mu R is the most important value. And what you see here is now this S18H means 18,000 is the value for mu R. So we have different materials, and let's make it very simple. Let's take manganese zinc and nickel zinc. And the first thing we can see here is now that the nickel zinc material is for higher frequency and the manganese zinc is for lower frequency, which makes it very easy to distinguish. But also we can see that the magnetic permeability increasing for manganese means that you have a higher permeability and a higher impedance value. So while we have a nickel zinc material for higher frequency, that means also you have a lower noise suppression in the lower frequency range. So also here you can see a trade-off. And this means finding the right material is also dependent on the frequency range where you either filter or where you use your switching, or where your switching frequency is. So let's go a little bit more deeper and make it simple. The simple way is that manganese zinc is for lower frequency and nickel zinc is for higher frequency. Well, that sounds very easy and very simple to understand. So now if I want to have something in the higher frequency range, if I want to filter, well, I take a nickel zinc core. If I want to have something in the lower frequency range, I take a manganese zinc core. And maybe there are some mixtures of both of them. Unfortunately, it's not that easy. It's a little bit more complicated because the permeability is complex. So the permeability of each material has two single parts. The first one is mu prime, and this is the inductive part, which shows me the ideal inductor, and this is the blue curve. But then we have also mu double prime, and mu double prime is the resistive part. It's our impedance, and this describes the losses, which is on this graph here, the yellow graph. So for each material, it's similar like this. You have a certain point until you have nearly an ideal inductor with no losses, but then at higher frequency, the losses of the material starts to increase until a certain point. And your application defines which value is more important. So if you want to have a DC-DC converter, then you need a real inductor, and for sure, you don't want to have low losses. And this means you need the point or a material where the mu prime is very high and your mu double prime is very low. So something around here in this frequency range. On the other hand, if you want to filter something because you were on the EMC lab and have a problem at a certain frequency, you want to have a filter, which means you use it as ferrite or choke. And in this case, you want to have high losses. High losses do you have when your mu double prime is very high? So something around this range. And here we can see the most interesting point. Any material has an ideal range, frequency range, where you can use it as inductor, but then at higher frequency, it's more used as a filter or a choke, whatever you call it. To understand this better, I will show you now the complex graph of this. So the set of the impedance of an inductor or ferrite, however you call it, is a part of R, which is the resistive part, and X, the inductive part. And for sure, the inductance is dependent on the frequency. The resistive part is not. And now you can calculate and see that the R, the resistive part, is belonging to mu double prime, and the X or the L is belonging to mu prime. So please keep that in mind. Depending on how and where and for what you use your inductor, it has different behavior. And either it's an inductor, an ideal inductor with a low losses, or it's a resistive part which has high losses, which has a high impedance. It's sometimes very easy to find this out in the data sheets, because if we give or if you find in a data sheet the impedance, it's always something which has more losses, and this is more a filter. If you see the inductance value in Henry, then you have an ideal inductor. So now let's make a summary. We have seen there are different materials, nickel zinc, manganese zinc, and ferrite-based metal inductors. I will go now deeper because this is an interesting technology for today's presentation, which is the power inductors. But you can see the strongest in the nickel zinc is that you have a nice resistance of the core, and also efficiency or magnetic saturation or inductance is fair. You have seen in two pictures below, or two slides before, we have seen that the inductance of the nickel zinc or the impedance is not that high. The manganese has a very high inductance value, but the magnetic saturation, also the resistance of the core, is, let's say, not perfect, but the efficiency is perfect. Now, the metal inductors, which I want to show now, they look very perfect, let's say nearly perfect. So maybe the inductance value is not that ideal. And because of this, we can use this for many different applications, either as filter or as DC-DC converter coil. Now, what is the special thing about the metal powder or metal composite or iron powder technology? Each one of these is called metal composite. So we call it CheMet Metcom, and you can see this from different manufacturers. And actually, the structure is always the same. So what you have is a copper coil inside. For sure, you have a terminal. But then you have a metal composite material, which is pressed around the coil. So this is a process which is not like the previous inductors we have seen 20 years ago, where you have a core, and then you use the wire and turn it around. You use the copper coil and press the metal composite material around the coil. So it's vice versa, the production process. But this one has advantages. Now let's have a deep look into the metal composite material. So the core structure of the metal composite inductor is not like a massive material block. It's more like a sponge with many, many powder particles. Let's call them balls. It's not a correct name, but that's the name how I call it. So each ball, you can see it here, each metal powder ball has an insulating coating. Why? I will explain that later. And all the balls are connected with a binder. Yes, because otherwise you have a powder and you have no inductor. And now you can see the advantage. The binder and the insulation coating acts as a distributed air gap. And we know that the air gap stores the energy. So instead of having or using the air around the inductor as air gap, we will have here an air gap which is distributed over the whole core. And this is perfectly for using this as an inductor because you have no EMC issues. Now let's go more deep into the wire structure. The wire structure is important. So you can have either a round wire or a flat wire. You can see it here in the picture. And all the other competitors are doing the same. There's no secret. That's not a Chemet secret. Why do we use sometimes round wire and flat wire? Well, I can make it simple. There's no advantage for one of them. Each one has its advantages. If you take a round wire, you can do many, many turns, and you get a high inductance value, up to 100 microhenry or above. But for sure, you have a low wire cross-section, and this means you have a high resistance, RDC. Also, if you have many turns, you need a long wire, and a long wire has also a high resistance. And a high resistance means finally that you have a low maximum current, and you have more self-heating of the component. A flat wire, okay, here you have reduced number of turns because you have a space issue, because the flat wire is from the cross section bigger than the round wire. And this means you have reduced maximum inductance. But the wire is directly connected to the board. So there's no connection like here, the black part. This here is directly the wire. And this means we have a reduced resistance. Also, we have a bigger wire cross section, as I just mentioned before. And this means also you have a reduced resistance. And as we are using a very short wire, because we are using a reduced number of turns, we have also, this is a reduced resistance. And finally, the reduced resistance, RDC, gives up a very high current, which is up to 100 amps. And the next point is also very important. We have a big wire surface. And that means you have reduced core losses at higher frequency. And when you're looking at the skin effect, this means you can use the components for much higher frequency ranges. So to make it very simple, the flat wire component is needed to have a higher frequency and higher current, whereas the round wire is used for high inductance values. To make it very simple for you, you don't need to choose a round wire or a flat wire component, and you will not find it in the data sheet. If you are looking for the values, if you have a high current value in your component, you will have a flat wire component. And now let's go on the next step into the mounting structure. As I have mentioned a few slides before, the previous way of building an inductor was the assembled type. So you have here a core, you take the copper wire and wound it around this core. And then finally, you put a shielding around. But the new series, the molded series, the metal composite or iron powder series, this one has a pressed or molded inductor type. And this means you have no air gap to the outside. This circle here, this is actually the air gap of the inductor of this type. But this means if you make a measurement, you can see that the magnetic field outside of the component, the magnetic flux, is much higher. Because yes, the magnetic field can go out. In the molded design, the magnetic field is totally concentrated, or nearly totally concentrated, to the inside of the component. And this is why we have only a look on the molded design, because this assembled inductor, which was previously used in the years before, is not something where we see the future. Also, there's another interesting point. If you look at the saturation current comparison, for those who have seen my presentation a few weeks ago, I was very deep in the saturation current. The metal molded design has a very smooth saturation current, which means even if you are at higher currents, the inductance drop is not that high. The assembled type you can see in that picture has one certain point where the inductance immediately drops. And this is dependent on the current, which means be careful by using assembled inductor and never use them at higher currents than the saturation currents. If you take the molded design, it's not a big issue to use it at higher currents because the saturation is very smooth and the inductance loss is not that dramatic like we can see it here in the assembled mode. And now let's compare the metal composite material to the manganese zinc material. And here we have a total different material, and this is the manganese zinc ferrite and the metal composite in these types. So, and we can see two things. The first thing is on this slide, the manganese zinc ferrite has, like mentioned before, this inductance drop at one point. And this means, yes, as you might remember, we have at a higher, we can use manganese zinc for higher inductance values, but then there's this huge drop. So we have the advantage of the metal composite is that we have a very slow saturation and it's very stable. But for sure, the advantage of the ferrite, of the manganese zinc ferrite, is that you have a higher inductance with a high permeability. So in the right range, the inductance is also very stable. But be careful and you should know your frequency range or your current range. The next one is the core loss. And here you can see the advantage of the ferrite, you have very low core losses in the dynamic frequency range of the manganese zinc. So it's not that metal composite is always the best solution. It's a good solution, but not all the best solution for any application. You need to know your application and what is your main task. So the metal composite, to do this as a summary, the advantages of the METCOM technology, you have the highest volumetric efficiency because you have no unused volume. You press the metal composite material fully around the core. Also, the magnetic field is fully in the component. So you have a reduced magnetic field, and this means you have a low EMI. And also we have this smooth saturation, which means we have higher currents possible. And this is the main advantage of this METCOM technology. Now let's come to the last part of my presentation. I want to give you an overview about all Chemet inductor series. So there are many, many series in the Chemet product world, but to make it simple, these are our focus series. We have more series than that, but these are the series which are the most interesting. So I will sort this. The most important one is the MPX or MPXV, and V in this case stands for vehicle, which means these are fully ACQ200 qualified. The MPLCG or MPLCV was an older metal composite type, and you can see on the first point there's no difference. I will show you in a few slides the main difference. And then we have MPCH, and this is a metal composite flat wire construction. You remember, flat wire is for higher currents and for higher frequency. And then we have the TPI series. The main difference is the manganese zinc core. Now let's go a little bit more into detail. So as product overview, the MPX or MPXV series, they are totally identical, and only if you need it for automotive application, you can take the MPXV series. They are metal composite shielded inductors. The inductance range is from 100 nanohenry to 100 microhenry, and we can give rated currents up to 100 amps. A sizes, as you can see here, are from 5x5 millimeters to 22x22 millimeters. And the most important advantage is the operating temperature range. It goes up to 150 degrees. Even if you don't need 150 degrees, it's much more better to have it for high self-healing, and you can use it at higher currents. The main advantage for the MPXV and the MPLCG or MPLCV is that this component fits to the common used soldering pads. So here you have no single source. If you use this component, you are able to find competitor items which fit on the same board pad. And here we are in the MPLCG series. So the MPLCG series is our, let's say, older inductor series. The inductance value is not that high. We only go up at 4.7 microhenry. And also the operating temperature is limited to 125. Also the case sizes are not that much. So we only have two or three different case sizes. So the MPLCG is nice to have and maybe fill some gaps, but it's not the ideal version. And the same is for the MPLCV. MPLCV, again, the V for the vehicle means that's ACQ 200 qualified. Also, this one is a metal composite shielded inductor, similar inductance range. Also, here we have only a few case sizes. But like for all automotive components, we are using here the 155 degree operating temperature range. The MPLCH is our flat wire construction. Here we have a very low RDC. The inductance value range, as mentioned before, is limited to low inductance values, which is not an issue. If you're using your inductor at high frequency, you don't need high inductance values, but you have a high rated current range and low losses. So this component is interesting for any application which has high frequency, maybe wide band gap application, wherever you need maybe low losses and low inductance values, but high frequencies. And finally, our TPI inductor series. And what is the difference here? I mentioned it before. This is a manganese zinc ferrite core we are using. And the most important thing is that we have a one turn flat wire construction. So it's always only one turn, which gives us a very low RDC. It's lower than 0.32 milliohms, and it allows us very high switching frequencies. And for sure, again, we can see here a limited inductance range, but this is interesting enough for all applications. And for sure, we have very high rated current ranges up to 93 amps. The case size is still very small. The smallest case size is 7x7 millimeters. And the operating temperature is up to 125 degrees. So this component is without ACQ 200. So, and with this presentation, I'm nearly at the end now. I can see a question which is very interesting. And the question is, can you explain what is ISAT and what is its significance while choosing an inductor? So let me go some slides back because this is when it comes to the saturation current. And here I can give a more deep view. Let's take this picture. And what we see here, the saturation current is the current where we see an inductance drop. So in, for example, we measure the inductance at increasing current. And at one point, the inductance drops, let's say by 30%. And when we have a drop of 30%, we define these points as saturation current. It's very important to know that this 30% is not a rule or standard. So any competitor can do any saturation, either if it's 40 or 50%. So there's no standard. It's very important also to know the behavior. So even if the ISAT is a nice indication of what is the maximum current, it's not always a limitation and you need always to look at the data. You can compare it with the DC bias of an MLCC. Also here, you only see one point, but you need to see the full graph and you need to understand your application current. If your current is at this point here, it seems to look perfect. But if you have a ripple current on top, then the inductance change is massively. So be careful by choosing your inductor and always consider the ripple current, which comes on top of your output current. I can see the question regarding the impact of cracks in the core. Actually, I've never seen any issue regarding cracks with the core. So usually each material we have seen before is very stable against vibration. I don't have exact numbers, but it's much more stable than the ceramic material of the MLCCs. So far, cracks of the core is not a big issue and is not a problem you might have. Okay, the next question. In the case of metal composite shielded inductors, there's a risk of, it's the same, okay. Is there a risk of cracking due to bending PCB? We have seen the same question before. Again, this component is very stable. Why? When you see the MLCCs, which have a very, let's say, sensitive material, the ceramic, which might crack, and then you have only layers. In the inductor world, you have always a wire, a copper wire. This copper wire will not break, and this copper wire is either connected directly to the board or via a connector pad or something. And this means any vibration is firstly going to the copper wire or to the connecting pad. And this means there might not, or there will not be a danger of a crack. So don't be afraid of any crack situation. I have in 10 years with this components, I have never seen any crack issue. Okay, there's an interesting question because now the cracks we have talked about. In case of Chemet inductors, what is the inductance drop H considering while defining I saturation? So when I'm right, I'm not sure if this question is regarding the aging or the lifetime of an inductor. If it's regarding the lifetime, there's no limitation. If you have a deeper question, if this does not answer your question, please come back to me and send a short message because I'm not 100% sure if this is if this answers your question. Okay, and so for the moment, also as we are now at the end, because I've planned to go until half an hour, we might have not answered all of your question. If you have still question, you can contact me at any time. And if I now go to the very last presentation slide, we have some upcoming events. So June 22nd, which is next week, Monday, at the same time, we have the third presentation, which is explaining the losses in magnetic-based components. So we go a little bit more deeper into the losses. On next Wednesday, the same time, we are going into the construction and characteristic of chokes. So here we are more in the common mode chokes, but today we were in the power inductors. So everything which is more the not filtering. And here we are going a little bit deeper into filtering. And then finally, on June 29th, we have the dispelling inductor myths. If you want to join the Chemet webinars, you can visit our webpage to register. And if you have still questions or I did not answer your question, you can contact me directly or your local sales or your local field application engineer. So and with this, I want to say thank you to all of you for joining today. And please contact me if you have more questions, and I hope to see you soon again. Thank you and goodbye.